interviewing the veterans of World War II, the greatest generation of those at St. Luke in Cabot, Pennsylvania. This is Roland Montag. He served generally in the Pacific Theater, and we'll just get into talking to Roland about his experiences, his background. First of all, Roland, were you drafted or enlisted?
Drafted.
You were drafted.
Right.
And what time frame was that?
January, when I went for my physical. Well, that's my notice. January of 42, July of 42, I had to go to Pittsburgh for my complete physical and also the swearing in into the Army itself. That was in July of 1942.
So that's 4 months from the time you were notified until you were
right.
Actually sworn in Pittsburgh.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And from there you went to, what was your first assignment from Pittsburgh?
Fort Meade, Maryland.
Fort Meade, Maryland.
Mm-hmm.
But Roland has kept very, very detailed notes of where he was when, so we'll review some of that verbally and then probably record this someplace where it'll be available to whomever would want to look at it. Given that Catherine will type it. Okay, at the time, had you known Catherine, or were you married?
No, we didn't get married until after I got out of the service.
Okay, and so...
I knew of her.
Were you going with her then?
No.
So it was no big event when you left as far as Catherine was concerned.
No.
So, 1942, June of 42. You went to a basic training camp then?
Went to from Fort Meade we went to Camp Wheeler, Georgia.
Camp Wheeler, Georgia, down in the heat. This is summertime now.
Right, so. August.
August, nice and hot.
1942.
A little bit different from Pennsylvania also.
We had a 6-week training course. I think we were the first group to go into the 6-week period. Before that, it was a 13-week period. At that time, there were many troops coming in, so they cut the course down to a 6-week course.
Yeah,
it was a basic infantry training course. We went through all the basics, which a general infantryman wouldn't receive.
Yeah. Typically, I think they trained everybody as an infantryman, and then you went into a specialty after that. And at that time, I think it's very interesting that we go from a 13-week course to a, how many week was yours?
Six.
So that's cutting it more than in half, just because of the demand for troops in that time frame. So things were really moving in the country at that time to mobilize and get as many troops online as possible.
Now the last day of the training period, we had a 26-mile hike, full field pack, and it must have agreed to me that it was 6 weeks, so I went from 135 up to 160.
Good food.
Right.
Yeah, and
then regular hours.
And you apparently got in shape in 6 weeks, because that was pretty good forced march.
Right.
You 26 miles is basically a marathon. So.
Yeah, that was the last day of our training.
And prior to coming in, you lived with your parents?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And then you left from your parents' house when you were drafted. Now, after basic training, this was at Wheeler?
Camp Wheeler, Georgia.
Camp Wheeler, Georgia.
It was located about 7 miles south of Macon.
Okay. And from there, after that basic training, what happened?
Transferred to Drew Field, Tampa, Florida, which was about 6 or 7 miles north of the city of Tampa. We were there until, with more classification, going on there, more tests, and what do you, but they seem to think maybe what you're good at and maybe not so good. And from there we went by train from Tampa to Kansas City, Missouri, to radio school, Morse Code radio school. Originally there were 600 of us were sent up there. At the end of 6 weeks, we had to pass 6 words a minute. There were 5 letters to a word. In other words, 6 words a minute, 5 characters to a grouping. It would be 30 words a minute. At the end of 6 weeks, you had to pass to go on to the next stage. And if you didn't pass that, you were sent back. Back to Florida. In that group, each succeeding week for 20 weeks, you had to pass 2 additional words a minute. There were some which they figured would be able to make it, so they did have not an advanced group of, but the ones who took 13 words a minute. You had to do that with pencil and typewriter.
Both. So you had to type as well as write.
So at that time I had not too much experience with a typewriter.
But, go ahead. Continue.
The ones who did pass, there were quite a few of those that were sent back at the end of a 13-week period. And the remaining of us, we had complete the course. It was a 20-week period, and we completed in March of 1943.
And so from the time you entered Kansas City, we're talking how many months?
About 6 months.
About 6 months for your training. And just if we can take a look at this, this is what the 5-letter group words look like. It's kind of mumbo jumbo as far as anybody.
There we go. I've got it.
Focus. Mm-hmm. And when he said you had to be able to translate that.
Can you pull that down one more? Put it
a little
up,
further?
Up, yeah.
Okay.
I got your finger. There we go.
Okay. Those are 5-letter word groups.
Mm-hmm.
And each one of these is one word.
Mm-hmm.
And then you had to continue improving on the number of words per minute you could get all time. And adding the typing part of it, there weren't many folks at that time going into the military that could type, I would assume.
I was one of them.
You were one of those that could type before you went in, which is...
Not that much. No. So we had to do both, pencil and typewriter.
So you took typing in high school?
Right.
Where did you learn to type before you went in? In high school? Did you have
no,
a typing class?
No, I never had typing.
Oh.
I just picked it up.
Nothing formal, you just
picked
it up.
No formal typing class.
Two things here. One, was it Drew in Tampa that you were at? It's probably today CENTCOM headquarters, which is Central Command, which is where the commander of all the troops in the Middle East now fighting in Afghanistan and Iraq resides. Mm-hmm. And it's probably the same base there as MacDill Air Force Base. And secondly, just to reiterate, like we did during Alfred Marhoff's interview, Morse code at the time and communications at that time were slow, typically unreliable, particularly voice communications. So many times if you're in a combat situation or whatever, if you're trying to talk on the radio, you just don't get through and it's not reliable enough. So Morse code was a very high demand and demanding occupation or skill. And today, you know, we've got communications coming out the ears with immediate feedback from the front and so forth. But at this time, the Morse code was reliable in that it was very early stage, but it was hard to intercept. It was hard to jam, and it was probably the primary means of reliable communications throughout most of the war. And so from Kansas City, then you went through the course and finished there as what? Did you get a promotion along with the school?
No, we had to complete 20 words a minute, high speed operator, with pencil and typewriter. And there were only 66 out of the 600 that actually completed the high speed course. We were sent back to Drewfield, Florida, and that's when we got assigned to a company, and everything getting coordinated to be shipped overseas.
So the company size unit was like how many? Two, so like 120 or?
I'd say about maybe 150 men.
Mm-hmm. And I believe you have a picture we'll look at later of
right.
That company mm-hmm. unit.
Of course, the battalion be a lot more than
now,
that.
Now, was everybody in the company a Morse code operator, or you were just assigned to the company and they had other functions?
Well, there was more than one. You usually had four platoons to a unit, to mm-hmm. the company.
Right.
And each one of those platoons were assigned a Morse code operator.
Operator, so one operator per platoon, and you had four mm-hmm. platoons. So right. basically, within that company, you had four guys like, or three other guys like yeah. yourself.
Right.
And did you pretty much stay together then as a company?
Yes, we were
after deployment
organized as a company, and we went through practice runs at Drewfield before we shipped out to Camp Stone, mm-hmm. California.
Okay, and just to reiterate on the company, what was the mission of the company itself? You were a communications specialist.
We were radar at that time was something new. They knew what it should do, but never had any experience with it. And we had four platoons to our company, and each one of those platoons had a radar unit. They were, as we went overseas then, they were located in different locations, and we had the operators out in the field. I was with headquarters, report communications from the field to headquarters, and we had to relay the information to the main control center, where they had a regular plotting board screen,
mm-hmm.
where they could plot all the coordinates and determine just where the enemy aircraft positioned were.
We probably should wait till it chimes up. Okay. Should record where
the aircraft were and how many there were in the flight and the direction they were coming.
Were you apparently this was anti-air?
Yeah.
Radar to detect
right.
enemy aircraft, not to control our own aircraft, but to detect enemy aircraft. And at that time, did they use actual aircraft with the radar, against the radar, or were these simulations?
I'm not definitely sure. I think it was simulation, more or less,
yeah.
at that time. Everyone knew what it should do, but up to that point, they never had any experience with radar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was brand new at that time. And
right.
Like at Pearl Harbor, I guess there was one radar that could have detected the aircraft coming in, but that was not reliable enough, or somehow the word didn't get through. Okay, so from there you're in California now.
Right, Camp Stoneman, about 40 miles inland from San Francisco.
Okay, so
yeah,
it would be like toward Sacramento. toward Sacramento?
Just 40 miles directly east of San Francisco. In the bay from
the... Was that still affected by the Pacific, or was this desert? I know inland from California coast, you go from
Camp
green
Stone.
To...
Camp Stone was located right in Pittsburgh, California.
Pittsburgh, okay.
And there was a regular steel mill right in that area, so...
I believe Alfred went through there also, Alfred Barnwell. Uh-huh. I remember Pittsburgh without the H. Either that or it was Alan Cook.
I'm not sure.
But, yeah, that apparently was an embarking holding area or something. Okay, and so now you're pretty much... destined to go into the Pacific theater.
Yeah, right.
And so, at Pittsburgh, how long were you at Pittsburgh until you deployed?
Oh, we were only there a couple of weeks. And I have it on that sheet.
But that's okay. With
40 mile so, inland, we went by these little tugboats from Camp Stillman up to the bay in San Francisco.
Oh, so you embarked then at San Francisco. And you went by ship, I assume?
Yeah, it was an Italian luxury liner, which was confiscated down in South America when the war broke out. It was 675 feet long, 75 feet wide, had five decks, carried a crew of 1,000, and we had 9,000 troops 9, on board. 000. Two of those decks were below the waterline.
And do you recall what number of, while it was still a civilian cruise line, how many people it typically took?
No, I have no...
What the capacity was?
Well, I think after the U.S. Army took it over, they converted it to a troop ship.
Troop ship.
Because all there was just regular aisles and bunks on both sides.
I imagine it was at least double or triple the number that normally would have gone on a luxury cruise.
Right.
And I guess also it might be noted that Italy at the time was our enemy. That was Mussolini territory, and so by confiscating the ship, it was one of the Italian ships, so it's kind of interesting. So your voyage took about how long?
18 days.
18 days. Any sickness?
First 3 days out of Frisco, I was flat on my back. And we had, 18 days. We went all by our... lonesome, no escorts. We did hear later when we got to Sydney that a Jap sub followed us for one day, but then I got the ship that left Frisco the day after we did.
Okay, so you sailed directly from San Francisco to Sydney, Australia.
Remember we crossed the equator, I think it was November 3rd, 1943.
Did you have any big ceremony or anything when you crossed the equator?
No.
Nothing? Did you know you were crossing it when you did?
Yes.
It was announced on the ship.
Gave us a little memento.
For crossing the equator.
Paper, crossing the equator, November 3rd.
And again, how many weeks was that?
18 days.
18 days. So that's pretty fast compared to some of the old troop ships.
Yeah, we were sitting ducks out in the middle of the ocean.
And once you hit Sydney, did you go to a military base there set up by the U.S.?
Just a camp area. We were there 3 days, and from there we went up to Brisbane. First, when we left Sydney, there was a wash out of the bridge, so we had to get off that train. Go across the vehicle bridge to the other side, get on the waiting train on the other side, got on that train, and then when we got up to Brisbane, they had a different gauge railroad, so we had to change trains again before we could to Camp Stoneman in Brisbane.
And at that time, can you recall where the Japanese were or where our forces were fighting the Japanese?
Mostly in the New Guinea area.
So that was going on when you arrived.
Right.
And what time frame again?
That was November of 43.
November of 43. Mm-hmm. And at that time, we had quite a few forces deployed, and we were kind of pushing the Japanese back out of New Zealand. Does Bougainville ring a bell?
Yeah, Bougainville.
Bougainville, had that already taken place?
I'm not definitely sure.
Uh-huh.
Our mission, it was a three-point landing in New Guinea, and that was in January. We went up to New Guinea.
January of 44.
44, yeah.
So then you were deployed with a naval carrying force, I assume, as and we didn't mention this earlier, but you were with the 5th Air Force, or
right.
Army Air Corps.
Yeah.
And so it was anti-air that the radar's mission, was the radar's mission, so therefore you were considered Air Corps as opposed to the Army. And you, I assume, deployed with Army. Were there Marines deployed with that three-point landing, do you recall?
Yes, I think they were involved. Our mission was to, I think we landed at Humboldt Bay, at the northern part of New Guinea. And most of the Japanese had been defeated at that time. So we were there from the spring of 44. Then we were getting ready for the big invasion, which in the Philippines.
Would have been in the Philippines.
Yeah.
So when you arrived, is this the first time your radars were set up and you set up your communications and fed information back to headquarters?
Yes.
The location and so forth, and alerting?
But there wasn't that much activity while we were in New Guinea.
Did you see
actually, it was a three-point landing, but we were in the northern part of it. But there was no
typically, did you see any Japanese aircraft at that time?
Yes. Well, most of it was destroyed on the ground.
Huh.
In fact, our headquarters was where we camped area. It was just above the, it was on a mountainside, and the Japanese airfield was down on the flat. And I have pictures of the all the aircraft which were destroyed.
On the ground?
On the ground, the Japanese airfield.
So after that three-point landing, this was in New Guinea, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then we occupied New Guinea after that, I assume.
Right.
Were there Australians involved also, or?
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. So you, yeah. Was there Australia responsible for any of the three points of landing?
Well, I'm not sure. We never heard exactly just how many, what all the other men.
Who else was doing or, what?
Yeah.
Because you're down in this little.
Yeah, we were up in the north.
Your own little world.
Actually, it was a three-point landing, and we were in the most
northern
part
of it. And from there, how long would you say you were on New Guinea then?
Oh, until, that was in January. We were up there, and we stayed there until, that'd be in October of 44.
So you're talking 9 to 10 months on New Guinea.
Yeah, probably about 9 months.
Uh-huh. And then your next set of orders were to take you from where? To
Late day. Up in the Philippines. Mm-hmm.
And that was part of another larger movement also, I assume.
That was a major thrust toward Japan itself.
Was this a big amphibious landing, et cetera, on Leyte?
And the convoy from New Guinea and to the Philippines, there was a convoy of 700 ships, no matter which direction you looked. Just ships to the right, ahead of you,
behind
you,
rear view, and each side,
and to the left side. That was quite a sight to behold.
Were you on a troop ship then also?
With the LST.
LST, which we just very recently had one visit Pittsburgh, the last remaining one. I think it leaves like within the next day or two. But did you probably saw the write-up about that in the papers?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Can you explain that for children who are watching this? What's an LST? Is it LST?
LST is landing ship transport. Yeah. And I just heard a discussion this morning. I was at the VA, and somebody mentioned that we didn't have guns on them when we were there. Did you have guns on the LSTs?
No.
Because the ones the one that came to Pittsburgh had guns on it, so it wasn't really armed. You had to be protected by ships around you. Mm-hmm. So you had destroyers, and what other naval ship do you recall? Did you have carriers accompany you? That you know of?
Carriers, cruisers, battle wagons. Aircraft carriers. I think any ship imaginable at that time which they used.
And was this a mixed force with the Australians and other countries, or was it primarily U.S.? Mm-hmm. Or was it a mixed force? And so when you landed, did they have a dock for the ship for you to disembark, or?
No, we pull right up to the shoreline. And we were able to get right off
Of the LST.
The
back of it drops down, or the front of it, I don't know which, but it's like a ramp that comes down, opens up. And did you have any
two doors? One open
on the sideways. Mm-hmm. And were there things other than troops on the ship, like tanks or other weapons? On the ship that you were on, or was it all troops?
Just
troops. Because mm-hmm. they could take tanks, and I'm sure like the armored forces went in, and then all the
just troops and our equipment.
And you stuck with your company then? Was your whole company on that same ship?
Yeah.
And
it was a couple of days before we were able to move inland. I did see MacArthur walk ashore that day. And of course, we had to wait there until they got all the area cleared of the Japanese, and then we were able to move into the capital, Tacloban. We were.
What was the capital again?
Tacloban.
Tacloban.
Mm-hmm. They took us back, and
I guess we
to the south side of the city. And that's where we set up our headquarters. And our other, as the area was cleared of the Japanese, then our other platoons were set up, part of the original company.
Interesting that you should see MacArthur land. And is this the landing that he made after he had stated, when he left the Philippines, "I shall return"? Was that his return?
Yeah, that was.
So that was the significant event, which has been written up many times in the history books, etc. Very interesting. And you saw him actually walk.
In fact, I saw him walk ashore down in New Guinea too.
Oh.
So I actually saw him twice.
So he basically, as I recall seeing the film, waded in, right? He went up to his knees or something, made it looked very, very monumental, which it was. Okay, from there you you spent how long on Leyte?
We were on Leyte until the following spring, March of
45,
right. Then we went by ship, it was LST, yeah,
again.
LST, down around the southern tip of Mindanao and on the west side of the bay into Manila. From there they put us on a, I call it a cattle car, but it opened gondola car. Took us by train from there up to Bam Bam, which was about 75 miles north of Manila. It was about 5 miles above Clark Field. Of course, Clark Field at that time was still under the command of I think the Army took it over before we got there.
But while on Leyte, your radar team, I assume, set up your company.
Yeah, our
platoon. Each platoon went out with separate...
Four platoons. Each had a radar. We were in operation 6 weeks, and during that time we had actually, at the time the Japanese lost their fleet out of the Leyte Gulf.
It was a big naval battle at that
right.
time.
Mm-hmm. At nighttime that sky was more glorious. Fireworks display you'd ever want to see. That lasted just night after night.
Did they have any battleships with the 16-inch guns firing either the prep before you went in or?
Oh yes.
Because I would guess a 16-inch gun would make quite a roar and.
See, our job
as
was
to light show.
Go in and get set up with our smaller units until they could bring the larger, until the area was secured and they could bring in the larger radar units. We were in operation 6 weeks. During that period we have actually 350 alerts, and half of those were actual raids. Of course that was the time the Japanese were
fighting for their lives.
Fighting for their lives out. That's when they lost their fleet out in the bay. Yeah, then in March of the following, in 45, you went by boat.
Now, you sent basically coordinates back on where your radar said the enemy aircraft were. As far as directing any friendly aircraft, U.S. aircraft, out to intercept them, was that... part of your mission
to pick them up,
you didn't direct them
no.
in any way. It was a matter of the coordinates that they were given that they then alert and scramble their force.
Ours was just to take care of the incoming Japanese flights.
And so 350 targets, possibilities, and half of those were
actual
raids. So that was heavy duty stuff going on at the time.
So we were in operation 6 weeks altogether.
Of course, back then they didn't have anything to detect radars and aircraft too, which was very helpful. They didn't know what was happening basically at the time, so radar was advancing as you went along. And it's interesting also that basically you were a tactical unit in that you had the smaller radar to go out and then it would be supplemented more on a strategic level by longer range, broader scope radar. You can see a whole lot more, probably more accurate, etc. And the whole system of scrambling and so forth, perhaps the big ones could, at that time, direct our own aircraft out for intercept. Mm-hmm. So that's just conjecture, but I assume that's maybe how it happened. But being on the tactical end of it is quite an accomplishment, being that you came back and didn't have any real problems. Did you have any close encounters?
We didn't have one bomb explode above our area. It put a hole in our tent, bomb fragments, but other than that, of course we had three typhoons also go through.
probably more dangerous than the
aircraft. In fact, we had where we had our radio units set up. There was like a gully from one hillside to the other where our camp area was. So it was about 3 days we had to take a rowboat to get across there. Of course, we had three typhoons altogether during the time we were there.
And the typhoon was mainly a wave coming in, or was it high wind?
A high wind, both.
High wind was the most dangerous part of it, and heavy rain.
Yeah. So our camp area was just like a deluge of water and mud.
Mud, yes. I imagine that was great to live through. And what were you eating at the time? Did you have a mess hall set up?
Yeah, they had a regular mess hall set up and regular cooks.
Yeah, was that pretty much true all the way up from the Guinea to Leyte? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You had
regular mess hall.
Mess hall and all that. So you're typically somewhere close to an airfield or somewhere associated with it. And then when the rains came, I imagine it was kind of messy for even setting up a cook tent and all that.
Well, they had a regular, I don't know if that building was there when we got there or not, but what they had the mess hall was a regular, like a bamboo building already.
Oh, so you had some kind of structure.
Yeah.
Did it flood over?
No.
Good. Just as an aside, when you got to the airfields, what did they have for the runways? Do you recall?
They had this
PSP?
Sort of a pieces of metal which they put down for the runways.
Yeah, that's PSP, probably perforated steel planking.
Yeah.
Which pieces, they'd be rectangular pieces that hooked together.
Right.
They were still using those many years later, but whoever invented those or constructed those, they did a whole lot of good because there wasn't much else, like with the rains and everything, to bring an aircraft in. Unless you had a good asphalt runway, especially with bombers, you need very thick asphalt, and this served basically the same purpose. And I think that's very interesting. So we're now into 1945, and it's what month that you made your next change?
Well, that's where we finally ended. We were about 70 miles north of Manila, about 5 miles north of Clarksville.
Bam Bam, that's easy to remember.
Bam. Mm-hmm. That time, we were getting ready for the invasion of Japan, which was supposed to take place November 30th, 1945, on the island of Kyushu, the southernmost island in the Japanese chain. And of course, we were getting instructed as the latest equipment was available for aircraft warning and also for also working with the American pilots. We were getting trained on that too. So actually it was just more...
So you could direct them, directing your own, like aircraft control type thing, and finding targets and directing them to intercept. So you had, did you have voice communications to pilots then, or when you were going through that, or?
Well, at that time, I think we were going to get that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Of course, when the war ended, we just more or less waited, I forget how many weeks altogether before we were able to ship out back to the States.
And of course, as most of us know from our history books, this is November of 45, but the war ended before then.
Right.
And that resulted from the dropping of the atomic bomb.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us what you remember about that and when you heard about it and when you were actually told, hey, we're not going to invade or have to invade, that Japanese surrendered?
we were actually picking up on the radio, and that's where we got most of our information as it happened. Just shortly after.
And what was the date of the Hiroshima bombing, do you recall? Just month, but that was in... I should know that, but don't.
Yeah, it was just...
About August?
Yeah, I think
it was about August of 45.
In a week or so ago.
Yeah. Yeah, and then a couple days later, they dropped the second bomb.
Yeah.
On Nagasaki.
Right.
And then, wasn't but a few days after, or soon after Nagasaki, that the Japanese surrendered.
Mm-hmm.
And so what would have happened had that not happened between August and November, and from November on after our invasion, could have been brutal. And there's a lot of contention about whether or not we should have done it. And just to voice my personal opinion, I think it was definitely the right strategic move. And what do you think?
I agree.
Because lots of life would have been lost, and the Japanese, you know, if they had the mentality they had, their troops had, while we were fighting them, it's a fight till the death. You know, driving some of them out of the caves and that, if that mentality was the same in Japan, it would have been really brutal. And so, I think having been exposed to that and probably the controversy afterwards, I think it was really quite a time in the history, our U.S. history.
Right.
And also serving those countries that we liberated, as well as certainly Australia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, after that, it was just more or less of a waiting period until we got the orders to pick up stakes and head for home.
Head for home. And tell us about that. You got notified, and then did you stage someplace before you got on ships, or did they just take you by train and load you on? And where did you move? What port did you come
from? No, I forget just how we did go down from our area north of Clark Field, whether don't think it was
Clark Field's around today.
I think mainly by truck, as I remember. Of course, we had to, and then we had a 14-day trip from Manila back to San Francisco. Then we got back to Camp Stoneman. We had to wait another week or so. It was right at Thanksgiving time. All the Pullman cars were being used, so we had to wait until they became available again before we made the trip across country and to Fort Monmouth, New Jersey.
Fort Monmouth? Is that where you processed out then, at Fort Monmouth?
Back that Sunday after, well, it was on a Monday. In fact, their train even stopped on Station Square in Pittsburgh. We were probably there about a half hour, but
but you would have just take the train through Pittsburgh on the way to Monmouth, and then after you got to Monmouth, did friends or relatives or
no
parents?
We were there arrived there on a Monday, and we got discharged on Tuesday, and we got to Pittsburgh at night about midnight, Pennsylvania Station. That completes the tour.
So that, and then, did somebody meet you at the airport then?
No, not at the airport. Down to
airport.
Station.
Yeah, train station.
Yeah, train station.
I gotta get geared back to it. Train time.
Yeah. Pennsylvania Station.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was just about midnight. Got off the train down there.
And how did you get home?
Oh. Well, family was down there waiting for me, my aunt, and they brought me home.
You were able to notify them ahead of time
that
you were going to be there and so forth. Just going back, when you moved your equipment in that. You mentioned you maybe went by truck in the Philippines to the port. Did you load, or were the radars loaded on like deuce and a halves, 2.5-ton trucks, or how did you...
Really, I don't know. When the war ended, I think we were getting all new equipment. It was the latest out. Uh-huh. So I don't know what happened to all that equipment. None of that was taken back.
Your company moved, did they? And they had a radar. How big was the radar? I mean, it certainly wasn't portable. Did you have to carry it around by vehicle, or?
Yes, uh-huh.
And then you had it set up. Do you recall how big the team was to operate the radar itself?
No, I don't recall. Well,
but I would guess about 3 people or so.
Yeah, I think it would be all together.
And now getting back to relationships you had in the Army, did you have contact afterwards with any of the buddies you met, or?
Yeah, about 3 or 4 of them, but I think, it's been years since I've heard from you. So I think most of them are gone now.
And after the war, did you personally visit any of them, or meet up with them somehow?
I was in contact with, was one out in Ohio. Used to write to him quite a bit. And there's one up in Michigan. In fact, he was our barber. And one down in Texas. So that was about it.
About 4 guys. Were these just people, like, they weren't other Morse code operators or radio operators? Or were they part of a team? How did you meet up with them, and what kind of things did they do?
Well, they were, a couple of them were radio operators.
Still from your radio school back in the States?
Mm-hmm.
Morse code school? Because it's kind of interesting to stay together with a unit that's like 100 to 120 troops all the way through the whole war cycle. How did your promotions go with, like, you when you got out of radio school, you got a promotion from, like, did you go in as a private, and then you got a step up to private first class, or?
Well, we went into radio school, we were all temporarily tech sergeants. Of course, that just lasted as long as the we were in school.
So, because it was an advanced school, you got...
Yeah. So then we went back to our units, then it was just... We were technicians of 5th grade, corporals.
Oh. That was the equivalent of a corporal rank?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I see.
Yes.
Relative to contacts with the church and home, did you get regular mail?
Yes.
Like, pretty much mail called daily? I know for a good part of the war, the Pacific Theater was a secondary theater, and the European theater got most of the support until that ended in Europe, and a lot of those troops were supposed to be involved then in the invasion of Japan. But did you have good support throughout, pretty much, like, for your mail? And like you said, you had meals and mess halls, and apparently that supply line was working pretty well.
Yes, our mail service was good. Mm-hmm.
So a letter from home might be a week later, or couple weeks?
Probably about a week later.
Week? Mm-hmm. That's very good. And at the time, did you stayed in contact with your parents, any other folks back home?
Parents, family members and uncles and aunts.
Lots of letters, huh? You had good support from home.
Oh, yeah. We were very good. Kept it up to date on everything that was going on.
Now, after you got out, what was the job market like?
Oh, went back to the previous job where I worked on.
Oh, so they carried you over from the previous job?
Oh, yes.
And that was?
Well, I discharged in December of 45, and I went back to work in February of 46. Mm-hmm.
And where was the work?
Helvigan, London, Brackenridge.
And then you stayed with them for a whole career. So how many total years did you have with Allegheny London?
42.
42. So it doesn't happen much nowadays with the moving around and selling of companies and taking over, et cetera.
Retired 1982, December.
82, and so talking about 28 years.
Yeah.
So have you enjoyed retirement since then?
Very much so.
Mm-hmm. Worked into it very well. And it's amazing to me the detailed memory you have on dates, et cetera. Just one more to tickle your memory. Most everybody remembers their serial number.
Yeah, 3328-5507.
Just like that. Very good. Afterwards, did you have anything to do with the Veterans Associations, American Legion, or VFW, or anything like that?
No, sorry to say, I never kept up with any of those.
But you were pretty well occupied, and as most people know, Roland lives practically across from the church here, and highly involved there through all the years. And you did get to the war. Have you been to the World War II Memorial?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about that experience?
Yeah, it was quite an experience. You see all those different inscriptions. And I remember the one that had one of Leyte in the Philippines.
Brought back a lot of memories.
Yeah, I met a gentleman there. He was a Air Force pilot over in Europe. It was interesting to talk to him.
Did he ever deploy then to the Pacific Theater, or
no?
He finished up in Europe. Mm-hmm. Was he a bomber, fighter pilot?
Bomber.
Bomber.
Mm-hmm. He was from Philadelphia.
Hmm.
Never got his name, but. We had a little talk for a while. It was interesting.
Well, as Tom Brokaw's book indicates, the greatest generation. You lived during a time, and I'm sure your military experience set a foundation for a lot of the other things in life, as far as... Well, just the experience and we maybe mentioned something about just what it was taking somebody out of working in for Allegheny Ludnam in Cabot, Pennsylvania, or living in Cabot, Pennsylvania, and exposing you to a world that you never knew existed, particularly in the Pacific. I won't say particularly, but in the Pacific versus the Europeans. We're typically a European community here, but Pacific is totally different with the Asian culture, etc. And that, mm-hmm. that must have been quite an eye-opening thing as far as you were able to buy from the local market. Did you have any items that particularly stand out, or even referring to food, did you eat a lot of rice?
No.
The mess hall pretty much had the meals. Mm-hmm. You didn't have to eat off the local economy at all. But as far as being able to buy anything like in Manila when you're passing through or anything like that, did you?
No, Never able to do that.
And you didn't have a girlfriend back home either, so you didn't really have to worry about that. Okay, well, we'll go on to the next tape then, and what we'd like to do next is to go through a lot of the stuff that Roland brought back and just give you a feel for some of the detailed information he has that is, to me, amazing.